Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Dobry wieczór państwu. Dobry wieczór. My name is Michael Kennedy, and I am director of the Center for European Studies, the European Union Center for Excellence, and the Center for Russian and East European Studies here at the University of Michigan. It is my great pleasure to welcome all of you here this evening and to introduce our provost, who will, in turn, provide the proper introduction for our most distinguished guest. I feel quite fortunate to be on this stage for many reasons, not least of which is because this night makes visible a culture of cooperation and mutual support for which this university is justly renowned. Tonight is made possible by support, first of all, from the European Commission through our European Union Center for Excellence, also from the offices of the President and the Provost of the University of Michigan. Tonight's lecture is also a very special event in the LSNA theme year dedicated to the theory and practice of citizenship and the International Institute's Citizenship at Risk series. But most of all, this event and this week are made with incredible dedication by my faculty, student, and staff colleagues in the Center for European Studies, European Union Center for Excellence, and the Center for Russian and East European Studies. I couldn't ask for a better collection of colleagues in the production of this event. Please join me in thanking all of them. Finally, I am not only fortunate because I am here with the leader of a country on which I have focused my life and career for the last 25 years, but also because I have my first opportunity to introduce to you a colleague from my very own Department of Sociology, who, not incidentally, is also the provost of the University of Michigan. Provost Teresa Sullivan came to Michigan from the University of Texas, where she was executive vice chancellor for academic affairs for the whole state system. We're fortunate to lure her up north, for she had been in Texas for most of the time since 1975 in both the sociology department and in the law school. Her research focuses on labor force demography with particular emphasis on economic marginality and consumer debt. I think I need to consult you, actually. She is the author or co-author of 6 books and more than 50 scholarly articles. Dr. Sullivan has served as chair of the U.S. Census Advisory Committee. And as you will see later, she is a very quick study of Polish pronunciation. At least, that's my bet. Beyond all of these very special qualities that Terry brings to the job, she also knows how to recognize excellence. I think this is evident not only in her choice to come to the University of Michigan, but also to carry out that long tradition of University of Michigan leaders dedicated to extending the university's capacity to be a global university and a public university at once, extending the university's capacity and commitment to the theory and practice of citizenship. Help me welcome and thank Terry Sullivan for extending our global, public, and even our Polish engagements this evening.
Thank you, Professor Kennedy, and I'm pleased to join you in welcoming everyone to this evening's lecture. As a newcomer to campus this year, I've had the opportunity to hear how to hear the University of Michigan present itself. One of the consistent themes, whether I'm meeting with historians or medical doctors or musicians, is the global engagement of the university. Our faculty have international reputations as scholars. But Michigan's internationalism is a great deal more than this. Faculty members in every school and college are engaged in research projects around the world. They relish opportunities to connect with other cultures and to gain new perspectives from their interactions with colleagues in other countries. Similarly, our students are excited by the opportunities Michigan offers for learning about other countries, cultures, and people. Our programs range from traditional year-long study abroad programs to faculty-led study tours in conjunction with undergraduate courses, and all of them are popular with students. The university also welcomes visitors from Europe, Africa, Asia, and Latin America each year. These diplomats, artists, scientists, and researchers provide rich opportunities for faculty, students, and the wider community to learn about other parts of the world. The university's relationship with Poland exemplifies our international engagement. It is multifaceted, with many colleges and schools, and with significant outreach to the community. The College of Engineering has, with support from the De Koppen Fund, developed a relationship with Warsaw University of Technology. The Copernicus Endowment has helped us to bring visitors such as Nobel laureate Czesław Miłosz, former Foreign Minister Bronisław Geremak, and composer Henryk Gorecki to Ann Arbor. We're grateful for the opportunities that the endowment has made possible, and we're appreciative of the hard work done by the volunteers and staff to make these activities successful. Tonight, we continue this tradition of learning from our distinguished visitors. It is our privilege to welcome Aleksander Kwasniewski to the University of Michigan. Mr. Kwasniewski served as the president of Poland between 1995 and 2005. He began his involvement in politics while studying at the University of Gdańsk in the 1970s and was involved in the student movement associated with the Polish United Workers' Party. In the last half of the 1980s, he held several important positions in communist governments and then represented the authorities in roundtable negotiations. His negotiated opposition to Solidarity and his search with his opponents for a peaceful resolution of their political differences in 1989 led to the end of communist dictatorship in Poland. It also contributed to the end of dictatorships across Europe. He was one of the founding members of the Democratic Left Alliance, served in the Polish parliament the same in the early 1990s, and defeated incumbent president Lech Wałęsa in 1995 for the presidency. Determined to become the president of all Poles, he quit the Democratic Left Alliance he helped to found and led Poland forward in the development of a market economy and democratic polity. Mr. Kwasniewski made a major contribution to Poland's future by leading the adoption of the new constitution in 1997. He led his country's entry into NATO in 1999. He was reelected president in 2000 and realized another of his long-term goals on May 1, 2004, with the entry of Poland into the European Union. Later in 2004, he used his impressive diplomatic skills in Ukraine, where he helped to bring about a peaceful and democratic outcome to the Orange Revolution. Mr. Kwasniewski first visited Ann Arbor in 1999. On that occasion, he joined other Polish leaders in reflecting on how Poland's transition to democracy might inform the global search for dignity, freedom, and truth. We're pleased that he is here with us again. We welcome this opportunity to explore with him the many lessons of Poland's peaceful transition to democracy. Please join me in welcoming President Aleksander Kwasniewski.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction, and I would like to start with some Polish words. Dobry wieczór wszystkim. Witam tych, którzy mówią po polsku, którzy są z Polską związani. Unfortunately, I will speak in English. Why unfortunately? Because my Polish is much better. It's excellent. English maybe is not so excellent, but I understand that the language of Ann Arbor, of Michigan University, is English, and I respect this rule of the university. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude and thanks for invitation to be in this university, in this very interesting place. How interesting, I tell you a little bit later. I have to thank for enormous hospitality, especially president of the university, Mary Sue Coleman, Madam Provost, Terry Sullivan, and for your introduction as well. Professor Michael Kennedy, thank you, Professor. He's a good friend of mine and good friend of Poland, and a man very much engaged in Polish-American relationships. So I think if you will applause Professor Kennedy for his wonderful efforts and engagement, would be nice for him. And I would like to thank Marysia Ostafin. She's a lady who organized all these Polish-American meetings here in the university. I remember my first visit in the year 99. It was the 10th anniversary of roundtable talks in Poland. I will speak about it also, but she's really, in Latin language, is a good word, good sentence to describe such a person. That is spiritus movens, that is such personality with full energy to do what is needed, what is expected, and what is, as usual, very successful. Marysiu, wielkie dzięki. Brawo. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I have to say I'm shocked. I'm second time in Ann Arbor, I'm second time in Michigan University. When I was first time, it was a very short visit, I was president. And of course, as president, normally we have very limited and very tight schedule. We have only time to come and to say something and then to leave. It was very interesting seminar about roundtable talks. Now I'm former president. And here in Ann Arbor, today even, tonight, I understood that I'm more and more former president. Because when I was president, it was quite natural for me that if I'm going on the scene, I'm going to sit in the most honorable place, and I should be there in such very important chair on the stage. And today, have you? That is what not what I prepared before. That is really, it's happened by accident. I decided to go to you and to use one of your seats. It means that I'm every day more and more normal man. And I'm very happy. I'm very happy. That is really good news for me, not only for you. But I'm shocked not only because this process of my personal normalization, that is, I think, even much more important, because I spent time in many places in the United States this year, but I came here to Ann Arbor Saturday, and Saturday, my first important experience in Ann Arbor was to participate in football match, Michigan-Iowa. And, you know, it was second time in my life when I watched football match. And, after this match, I understand that I'm soccer fan. that's, you know, it's true. So I promise to you that everything what I say today will be absolutely true, because I'm former president. If you, I'm not a candidate, I'm not a president, I'm former president. And that is the most promising thing. But what was very surprising for me, 110,000 audience. I was in my life chairman of Polish Olympic Committee. I participated in many opening ceremonies of Olympics in Seoul, 88, in Atlanta, 96, in Sydney, 2000, in Athens, 2004. Never I met 110,000 audience. Normally it was something close to 100. In Michigan, in Ann Arbor, 1,010. Chinese result, congratulations. Second, it was Sunday here, here, in the music place here in Ann Arbor. I participated in the concert of two Shostakovich symphonies, performed by one of the best orchestra, Kirov Orchestra from Petersburg, former Leningrad, and conducted by my good friend, because I met him several times in Petersburg, in Poland, Vasily Georgiev. It was really fantastic music. I understood that you are much better as Europeans, because in Europe to hear one Shostakovich concert per day, that is more or less maximum what we can accept. But you are better, two concerts per day. But it was really, it was very, very, very impressive day. Then Tuesday, yesterday, I was here in Ann Arbor, and I seen Royal Shakespeare Company, Antony and Cleopatra, in fantastic performance, 3.5 hours. But really fantastic. Professor Kennedy, when I asked him how he understands old Shakespeare, he said that more or less in 50%. You can imagine in how many percent I understood. But it was very touching as well. And that is the next example, that Ann Arbor is the center of the culture, the center of events. And what was for me very nice, I mentioned Georgiev, who is my friend, but Royal Shakespeare Company is conducted by, I have to say, maybe that is not very modest of what I will tell you, but by my friends, because the patron, the president of this company is His Royal Highness Prince of Wales, Charles. I met him several times. And the patron of this company is Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. I met her many times also. It's nice, even not directly, but to meet so many friends in Ann Arbor during 3 days. I know that here in this room are my friend, my university mate from Gdańsk University, Ola Terlecka. I don't know where is she. Let's stand up. We spent wonderful 5 years in Gdańsk University. And then in the year 76, I was here in the United States as a young student. I was only 21. I traveled, and I delivered cars almost 4 years with my friend, our university mate, Eli Kisawa. And I visited 33 states of the United States. And you know what's funny? That I visited these 33 states of the United States, and it was not a political campaign. I was running for nothing, you know? Americans, if they visited so many states, it means that they need something. And, you know, I was absolutely volunteer. And finally, we met in Detroit. I remember this wedding ceremony. It was some from your family. And I'm so glad that after so many years, you are here. And thank you for your presence. So that is fantastic. 4 days in Ann Arbor and football, Shostakovich, Shakespeare, and tonight Kwasniewski. And now, sure. And now it's more serious task, because it's necessary to speak about the subject of this lecture. And Professor Kennedy is a very ambitious man, because he decided that I should speak about 30 minutes, no more as 40, to give time for questions, but about democratic revolution, international conflicts, and global citizenship. I think that is a good idea, Professor, to invite me again for 6 months, and then I will speak about all these issues day by per day, but that is so wide subject that, of course, I'm not ready during 30 minutes to speak about these questions briefly and to speak about everything. So I would like to start with some remarks, and then I give floor to you to ask me what is most interesting for you. I think the question of democratic revolution is something crucial, and is something crucial for my political life as well, because first, the sense of this two words, democracy and revolution, democratic revolution, sounds a little bit paradoxically. We know from the history that revolution is something what is going against existing rules, existing law, And that's something what is, in fact, many times against something what we can call democracy. We remember American Revolution, we remember French Revolution, we remember Russian and Soviet Revolution in the beginning of 20th century. The concept of revolution is to destroy existing rules and to create new rules. And of course, the new rules we can name as democracies, as a proletarian dictatorship, as the best system, political system in the world, how you want. But revolution is something what is destroying the rules and is creating totally new rules on the ashes of former political systems. Of course, we have not only one method to change political system. We know from the history that systems were changed on the way of wars. So the list of the wars is very long in the civilization. I can mention the First World War, beginning of 20th century, and the collapse of the system of monarchies. Then the Second World War, and the division of the world, and the start of Cold War, and end of the Nazis, and this main struggle, democracy and democratic values of the West versus communist values of Soviet Union and Soviet bloc. Of course, we can speak about very fresh experiences connected with Balkans War. We decided about the new picture of Balkans and the change of political system in all these countries, etc., etc. Of course, the list is not full, and I think when we would have more time, we can speak about this much more. But what happened in Poland, and in what I participated very strongly, and what is one of my main experiences in political life and my pride, that we decided and we organized in Poland in the end of 80s, and especially during roundtable talks, 89 and after, really democratic revolution. So we decided to change political and economic system and the way of dialogue, of political debate, of two opposite sides, and on the way of, on the base of compromise, and on the base of democratic election. That is something what is very unique. And our experience was first, we started these changes in Central and Eastern Europe, and sometimes we are a little bit jealous, frankly speaking, we Poles, that if in the world are speaking about the changes and the symbols of the change of the 89-90, the main picture is the collapse of Berlin Wall. But of course, that is more spectacular. You know, millions of Berlin's people and the wall, destroying this wall, it was very, how to say, Hollywood scene. You know, talks, roundtable talks, 2 months of talks, discussion, documents, changes. That is not very spectacular. Even Steven Spielberg would have some problems how to show this very sensitive and difficult and dramatic process in some movie. But it started in Poland. Poland was first, and Poland, in fact, opened the doors for next so-called socialist or communist or Soviet post or Soviet countries or countries of Soviet bloc in our region. After Poland was Czechoslovakia, Hungary, first Hungary, Czechoslovakia. In December 89, Romania with very dramatic revolutionary events. You remember this helicopter with Ceausescu and then this Ceausescu sentence to death and the execution of Ceausescu. So everything happened very spectacular after, but beginning was in Poland, and our idea was such change based on the values of dialogue, compromise, and democratic values and democratic election. And we succeed, and I'm very glad, and I would like to underline it again, that this conference 99, still in the whole history, after roundtable talks, is the most important, with the best participation of representatives of various groups in the history. Unfortunately, never in Poland, Even when I was president, I tried to organize something similar for the 15th anniversary. It was impossible. So for everybody who organized this conference, and Professor Kennedy gave me the documents yesterday, I found, I hope that no journalists are here, even I didn't remember that I was in this same panel with Lech Kaczyński, who is my successor now. So, but really, the list of participants was excellent. Discussion was on very good level, and it was the best discussion organized for not only for roundtable as a political event, but for the concept, as a discussion about the concept of such peaceful democratic transformation of political system in somewhere. Not only in Poland, but somewhere. So I'm very, very grateful again, and I thank you, Marysia, and you, Professor Kennedy, that you were enough brave and enough clever and enough visionary to organize this conference in the year 1999.
I have to say, Brian Porter is also...
Brian Porter, yes, thank you, too, yes, yes. That you are a little bit now in the shadow for me from this side, but you are a very bright person of this meeting. It was really good. And of course, I'm still sure that it was the best solution for Poland, and it is the best solution for many countries. To some extent, in my political life, roundtable, that is something what is connected with my political career very strongly. Because I was active as a co-chairman in Polish roundtable, and when I tell you that my co-chairman in this group, it was the group for trade union, pluralism, etc., was Mr. Mazowiecki, who started to be first non-communist prime minister in Poland. But his main advisor was Lech Kaczyński, who is now my successor. And a lot of people participating in roundtable talks, they were really the father of Polish democracy and father of many of next Polish governments. That it will show you how this event, this talks, and this procedure as such was important for Poland for next many, many years. And I'm extremely against such thesis which you can hear now in Poland, that roundtable was something what was not connected with some secret agreement among Communist Party and Wałęsa and opposition. It's absolutely, I will use not very academic word, but it's bullshit. That's absolutely. I'm so sorry, but I'm former president. I can say what I want. Yeah, in my life, you know, to be not so much diplomatic, this is some of advantages. I met former President Clinton some months ago, and we discussed what it means to be former president. And he had very good description. I think this is a very clever description, and this is true. So he said, you know, to be former president, that is such very strange, very special combination of liberation and frustration. Frustration because we cannot influence the situation in our countries internationally, but liberation, but finally we can say what we want. So you see in front of you very liberated man. And not very much frustrated still, but not without some frustration, especially when we speak about domestic situation. But I will not speak about domestic situation. If you will provoke me, I will answer, but I will not speak about it. But why I speak that told you that this round table is very much connected with my political life? Because you don't know about it, but in the year 92 and 93, I was invited as an expert of round table talks and this political compromise to South Africa. I spent some weeks as an expert for CODESA talks, in the last period of CODESA talks in South Africa, and I discussed with all leaders of all sides of African political landscape how to reach the compromise. Those time I met leaders of ANC. I never met Mandela those time, but I met Ramaphosa, I met Buthelezi, I met Chris Hani, who was one of important leaders of ANC movement. And I think our experience, Polish experience, was used by South African in a very positive way. And even if it was because of activity of such people as Mandela and Desmond Tutu, Bishop Desmond Tutu, it was enriched by a very important element of national reconciliation. What, in my opinion, is a real lack of Polish situation, but that is very detailed question. I think during roundtable talks, and especially after first election, we should propose something like the Commission for National Reconciliation to judge everything what happened in the past, positively, negative, and to say who was a hero, who was a dark person of this period. But this is, of course, passé. There's nothing to say more about it. And then, why I speak, that roundtable is so connected with me. I was invited to Ukraine to organize roundtable talks in the very strong, very difficult and dramatic crisis after falsified presidential election in Ukraine in the year 2004. And Polish experience to organize talks was extremely useful. Because, in fact, my first proposal to Ukrainians when I went to Kyiv with Javier Solana from European Union and with President Adamczyk was 3 points. First, no violence. Second, let's start to speak. Third, we should solve this question in the legal way. And we realized all goals. And with violence, it was a question of 15 minutes, in fact. 15 minutes. Because when I finished my first meeting with President Kuchma, I was informed by Polish intelligence, which sometimes is better informed as American intelligence, that in Kyiv, the action against people on the Independence Square is prepared. The miners from Donetsk, 60,000, are prepared to attack these people. And then I had the chance to call to people of Mr. Yanukovych to stop this action. And really, in fact, this is one of most dramatic 15 minutes in my life. Because these 15 minutes decided that we'll go to speak or we'll go to have bloodshed, victims on the square, and no chances for roundtable talks. But finally, we realized everything. No violence, dialogue, and third round of presidential election and fair election, finally. And of course, I don't speak what happened next year or next 2 years, but that is politics. But what is concerning values, democracy, and the concept of compromise and dialogue, we won. We were victorious. We were absolutely successful. So that is what I would like say to you in this first remark. I'm the great fan and supporter of idea of dialogue, compromise. I'm sure that the compromise that is not the evidence of weakness. I'm sure the compromise is evidence of wisdom. That is a concept how we can organize life of various groups of people with different political approaches, different political concepts. And of course, to find compromise is not necessary to resign of own ideas or own values, but is necessary to be open for the ideas or values of your partners or opponents. Sometimes this is very difficult. Sometimes that is really, this line is very, very weak. But that is the sense of compromise, and in my opinion, that is the sense of political and life and public activity. I think sometimes if you have one side politics and the leaders which who believed in own ideas, values, that is very dangerous. That is very dangerous because we, first of all, we can split the society, and secondly, we are not able to use the potential which is coming from other side, from the side of opponents of different political partners. I said many times to my party colleagues when I was leader of the party. I said, look, if you speak about people, if you speak about nomination, let's understand one thing. No, all eagles are under our roof. You know? So not all the best people are in our party. Not the best specialists are with us. Not the best professional people, politicians are in our team. Sometimes it's necessary to say, well, this guy, he's from different side, he has some different ideas, but he's good. And that is what I would like to tell you as my political experience. Of course, you know, if some who knows me and know my political activity can accept that if my name would be not Kwasniewski, what is so difficult to pronounce, and I appreciate very much your pronunciation, and I know that in America even some politicians decided from the very beginning to ask me Aleksander because it's much easier as Kwasniewski. So I should have a name, Mr. Dialogue of Mr. Compromise, and I'm not, I have nothing against. In fact, my political life and my character, my political construction is such. I'm a man of dialogue, I'm Mr. Dialogue or I'm Mr. Compromise, and I'm very proud about it because I think this is much more successful way to organize common efforts to reach positive objectives as to be man of revolution or Mr. Revolution or Mr. Of divisions. So that is the first what I would like to say. What with time?
Yes, to die.
Yes, okay. Fine. You will control me, so that's it. The second is, I add one thing, what is practical evidence of my words. Because yesterday one of young students from Polish-speaking students asked me, well, you speak, but I'm a young man, I need evidence. What you have done? So, I tell you, this concept of compromise, of unity was very important for Poland at least during my presidency three times. When we decided about Polish Constitution, 97, entry to NATO, 99, and membership into European Union, 2004. First Constitution and third European Union decision was made under the way of national referendum. And we won all these referendums. And it was necessary to organize common approach and not to be the leader of one party. It was necessary to have not bipartisan support, but multi-partisan support, because in Poland we have much more parties. My first slogan for the election was let's choose the future. But then when I was elected, I resigned of my party career, and I said to my countrymen, I would like to be president of all Poles. And of course, it was not easy because I had 52% of support, but 48 voted for Mr. Wałęsa. But I think finally I succeed this concept. And in second election, 2000, my slogan was Poland, the home for everybody. Yeah. And you know, this idea was very, very funny because you know who suggested me this idea? It was the year beginning of my first presidency, the year 96. And all old, but very nice, very clever president of Italy was my guest in Poland, in Warsaw. And he was a representative of Christian Democratic Party, and I was a leader before, of course, the leader of Social Democratic Party. And the first words of President Luigi Scalfaro in Warsaw were, Mr. President, I'm so glad that you won the election. I was very surprised, the man from Christian Democratic Party, the representative of the very conservative part of Italian society, they speak that he's happy that I won, but I understood he's old, maybe he knows or not where he is and with whom he is speaking. It was very unfair from my side, of course, but I asked, well, but why you are so happy that I won against Mr. Wałęsa? And he said, you know, because in such Catholic country as Poland, and Catholic is speaking, Skalfar, the very Christian democracy of Italy, very Catholic personality. He said, you know, in such country as Poland, with such huge majority of Catholics, you are not Catholic, you are agnostic, that's very good that you won, because they give chance for Poland, your election, give chance for Poland that Poland will be, and he used wonderful Italian words, Poland will be casa di tutti, the house for everybody, home for everybody. That you will not exclude for your society the people, non-believers, Orthodox, different religions, etc. And it was surprising statement of this old man, but very clever and very important for me for next 10 years. Because in my opinion, and that is what I try to message, to convey as a message to my successor, the role of president, not the role of governments, not the role of prime minister, but the role of president in Poland is to be such man of who is fighting for unity, for national unity, who wants to collect individual efforts for common positive results, who is able to organize Casa di Tutti. That is something what I think I succeed, and I finished, I would like to tell you, I finished my presidency with support in public opinion polls on the level 60 or 60-something percent. I wish all presidents in the world to finish their presidencies with such results. Okay, next question, not briefly, is international situation and what we, maybe even before, I would like to say some words about what we can offer, because I was asked many times, Polish history after 89 is so successful, you are democratic state, you have developing economy, you are in NATO, you are in European Union, etc. What you can offer to your neighborhood, to countries in during transition. And I'm quite modest because I know that we had successes, but we had some problems and we made mistakes. And I would like to tell you what I see as our successes and what we can offer as some positive experience from Poland to other countries and what is necessary to rethink and to be more careful and maybe to offer quite totally different recipes. Successes. Of course, first Polish success, constitution. Constitution prepared and adopted, accepted by the people in national referendum, 97. It means strengthening of Polish democracy. It means independent juridical system. It means independent media. It means full protection of human rights. It means protection of the rights of minorities, etc., etc. Second success is a free market economy that's changed Poland dramatically. In the year 89, 85% of Polish GDP came from state-owned sector. Today, 85% of Polish GDP is coming from private sector. In the 17 years ago, 85% of Polish export was oriented to Comecon countries, socialist countries. Today, 85% we sell for European Union, Western countries, etc., etc. So that is a huge success. We have strong currency. You know, that is something unbelievable, even for me. I was here, I mentioned, 30 years ago, and then I remember the price of 1 gallon of gasoline was 50 cents. And 2 small pints of Coca-Cola was 50 cents too. And for us, $1 was terrible because $1 in Poland in the black market was 2 bottles of vodka. Could you compare four pints of Coca-Cola and 1 bottle of vodka? You know, what to add? You know. And today, you know, I'm going to the shop. I buy New York Times, I pay $1, and for very good newspaper in Poland, Rzeczpospolita, I pay 3 zloty, what means $1. Terrible, terrible. And unfortunately, those time, 30 years ago, I spent money in dollars, and it was very painful. Today, I earn money in dollars, and it's not enough. And that is the change. But next point of our success is education. In Poland, we have 2 million students. What is per head, much more is Germany. We have state universities, we have private universities, we have really educational boom. What is fantastic. We have very strong local authorities. We decentralized power after the changes in 89, and I think it's one of the sources of Polish success. It was not repeated by many of post-communist countries, and that is a mistake, because decentralization is something what decided to use full energy. And we have today nice cities, nice provinces, we have nice villages, we have really such a lot of energy, which is not very much engaged in the central projects, but in these local projects is much engaged. We are in NATO. Our membership in NATO means not only security for Poland, but it means that what is not very well known here, that first time during 1,000 years of history of our neighborhood, Poland and Germany are in same political and military alliance. Well, this is nothing to laugh. This is something what is really crucial and substantial change. We are in European Union. That is a huge chance for civilization progress. I will answer the question because I see that the time is going so fast. We have good neighborhood, and this neighborhood is something what is very unique too. Yesterday I told to the students, and I repeat this, what you have to know. Poland is in very special, in very unique situation in Europe or in the world, because during the last 17 years, we didn't change our borders even by 1 centimeter. And we changed all our neighbors. No one old neighbor exists. No GDR, no more Soviet Union, no more Czechoslovakia. We had 3, we have 7. We have Federal Republic of Germany, we have divorced Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic and Slovaks, and we have Ukraine, Belarus, Lithuania, and Russia in very special place, Kaliningrad region. And during my presidency, and during the 17 years of Poland, we found the good language, and not only we signed treaties, but we created really very strong, good, positive neighborhood relationships with all neighbors. And last but not least, it was what I proposed as a president, very difficult process of reconciliation. And that is something what we can offer to many partners everywhere, in Turkey and Armenia, in Israel and Palestine, in Balkans, in many places of the world. That is the process of reconciliation, what means that we are obliged to overcome all these tensions, historical tensions, which are existing, which are creating very bad stereotypes in the relationships of nations, states, and people, etc. And in Poland, we succeed at least in such process of reconciliation with Germans, with Ukrainians, with Lithuanians, and first of all, with Russians. We started, that is not easy because the position of Russia is a little bit difficult in this case. But first of all, we succeed this process, what is very painful process, very difficult, with Jews, with Jewish diaspora in the world, with because before the war, you know, this Jewish community was very strong in Poland. It was more than 3 million people. It was the second biggest Jewish community in the world after the United States. And because of Holocaust, because of that Nazis murdered these 3 million Jews, and happened some Polish pogroms, that it was not the mainstream of all this. It was absolutely on the margin, but it happened. And to organize, to start with the process of reconciliation, Polish-Jewish reconciliation was extremely difficult. And that's we can offer. That's we know how to reach these results, and I think that is this part of positive things. But we have some weaknesses, and that is the last point of my introductory remarks. The first, of course, I cannot understand even, I met many times Polish sociologists, maybe it's necessary to ask American sociologists about it, because maybe they are better, you have some distance. Poland was pioneer at the fight for democracy, for freedom, and when we finished this fight, and we had first free election, you know, the participation in the election turnout was very low. It was something around 60. But last election, the turnout was 40%. And it means that still we have a problem to organize and to create in Poland the real civil society, what is the main weakness of democracies everywhere. I think in the United States too, the problem is how to encourage, how to engage people to democratic procedures. Because democracy without voters is procedure only. That is without substance, without sometimes even without sense. And I'm very afraid that this process of dropping down, decreasing number of voters, it will be very encouraging for politicians with some concept of strong hand for dictators. Because they can say, look, the people are not interested about the procedures. The procedures are unacceptable. And they need a leader. They need, of course, enlightened leader. Or even better to say, enlightened dictator. But because I read a lot of books and I try to find a good example of enlightened dictators. And you know, the secret of this description, enlightened dictator, is that there are two words. Even if he's enlightened, his or she, like Katharina the Great, she's dictator. And it means that it's a combination of some good ideas, but victims, crime, violence against minorities, against political opponents, and so on. In my opinion, if we can speak about democratic revolution, what sounds paradoxically as well, we cannot speak about enlightened dictatorships. Because that is, in fact, impossible. That is, in fact, impossible, and it costs too much. But these weaknesses of democratic procedures can be very encouraging for such people with such ideas. And I don't speak theoretically. I speak about many leaders in Europe. I speak about some leaders in Poland as well. And that is really dangerous. And so the first weakness, and that's Poland cannot be good example, is a weakness of civil society. The second is more economic and social situation. I was asked many times why in Poland this change of the power was so dramatic last election and what happened, because the results of economy are so good. Poland has one of the best economies in Europe now. We have almost 6% growth of GDP. We have inflation on the 1% level, we have good export, we have less unemployment. Economy is extremely good, but in Poland, unfortunately, the voters are not voting for because of the economy. They are voting because of many different reasons. And I think the main problem, and this is my mistake, this is mistake of our governments, was that we were sure at the beginning of Polish changes that we have the situation that the transition in Poland, the change of economic system, means that we will have beneficiaries of the reforms and losers of the reforms. But the number of beneficiaries will be much bigger as losers. And we have such very comfortable situation that we have, first of all, beneficiaries and not too many losers. I think somewhere in the year 1999-2000, this situation changed. It changed not because it was some crisis or collapse of Polish economy, but because the pace of the growth was slowed down very much. And for many family enterprises, for many small businessmen, that started to be that they have some feeling that they cannot develop, they cannot make progress, and they are immediately not in the group of beneficiaries, but in the group of losers. And I think I understood now, because I'm watching CNN, and in CNN everything is broken. Broken government, broken Congress, broken borders, everything is broken. But we had such broken balance of beneficiaries and losers in the year 1999-2000, and we created big group, which we underestimate, in fact, the big group of frustrated people. And that is something what is necessary to say to all governments, to all countries in time of transition. Be very careful with economic policy, with social policy in this element, to create or not, that's my message, is not to create the big group of frustrated people because of the changes, because of the lack of active social policy, etc. It's costly. It's costly. That is very much against such very pure liberal approach to the economy. But it's necessary to do. And I think it was our mistake that in the year 1999-2000 we were not enough sensitive to understand that this balance, this equilibrium is changed or starts to be changed. So that is next message from our negative experiences. The next is this question, what is very important for United States and for many European countries. This is a question of community, of exclude people and include people, inclusion and exclusivity and inclusivity. And that is something what sounds sometimes as a very academic debate, but it isn't. It is a very serious problem for all democratic countries in the world. Inclusivity, exclusivity is necessary to find such concept of the state, such concept of civil society, such concept of social policy, and international policy as well, to take people together and to include people to these projects and politics. Because the day when majority of people, that it means voters as well, will feel that they are excluded, they are not participating in the processes, it will mean that is a beginning of the end of democratic systems in the world. And that is not overestimation from my side. That's I'm not ready to be so original or so, you know, to speak so dramatically, but I'm sure that this process today in the beginning of 21st century is quite serious and is necessary to answer of these challenges. I prepared much more, but because I said that it's impossible during one lecture to speak about all this very important, interesting issue, I think I should finish, yes, now?
Yeah,
and to be ready to answer your questions. And I promise one thing to you. If Professor Kennedy would be so nice to invite me again, I will continue. Thank you very much.
The first question that I have here, Mr. President, does Poland's close relationship with the United States cause problems with its relationship with European countries?
With some of them, yes. First of all, I would like to say that I was a politician who was very much not only engaged, but I believed that in sense of very close Polish-American relationships. I tried to explain this to my European friends, what was sometimes not easy, especially with France. The first of all is history. Poland and America are very much connected. According to last census made in United States in the year 2000, 11 million Americans, they have some Polish roots. So we have a big Polish community here. I have bad news for the people from Chicago, because many years
We were sure that after Warsaw, the second biggest Polish community lived in Chicago. But unfortunately, the last information are different. The second biggest Polish community is living in New York. The third is in Chicago. But this is here 1 million, here 1 million. But that is traditional ties, and I think we have to protect these ties because they are important. Second, we are grateful to United States because of American support for Polish aspiration for independence, sovereignty, democracy. Because we know, we remember very well that in the years 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s, we had support from American side, and we had so-called real politics, realpolitik, it was in German, from European side. Realpolitik in Europe meant that, Yalta is Yalta, Potsdam is Potsdam, Europe is divided, what to do, we have to accept. So, the second, America helped us very much in this, to realize these aspirations. America supported us on the way to NATO, and we know all these things. Of course, position, especially during Iraq's crisis, position of Europe was very divided. We were in same group with United Kingdom, Spain, and unfortunately, position of France and Germany was totally opposite, different. Some experts of politics, they sent me letters, and I remember one letter, I will not mention the name of this man, and he said, Mr. President, this politics is wrong, because if you are so close with United States, please remember whole time that the river which is flew through Warsaw is not Potomac, but Vistula, and that we are going too far with Americans. In my opinion, it was correct decision. I don't speak now about Iraq. Maybe you have the question about it, but I don't like this question. because they're difficult, of course. But our decision to be with the United States in the very difficult time of Iraq's crisis and the terrorist fight was positive, good, and of course we had some tensions with our European partners. I remember so-called triangle, Weimar's triangle, which we organize every year, French president, Polish president, and German chancellor. And after Iraq's crisis, I organized this meeting in Wrocław, in Poland, and it was one of the most difficult because it was necessary to start to discuss this Iraqi issue. And in the beginning, the atmosphere was very frozen. But finally, we finished this day with good Polish restaurant, with good Polish food, and not only. And it even was difficult to say to President Chirac that it's very late. He was so happy with good food and good drinks. But it was difficult time, and of course it was costly for Poland. This decision to be so close with United States was not easy, was costly, but in my opinion was very absolutely right decision. And I'm ready to fight for this decision again. Iraq is a different question, but to work and to close our cooperation with the United States, I'm sure that is something what is good for Poland and good for United States, and is supporting Polish position in European Union too. That is true, because we are close allies of United States. It means that in European Union our position is stronger, not weaker. It's more difficult, but it's stronger. I know that it sounds paradoxical, but it's so. That sometimes it's necessary to show that you have own opinion to be more respected.
We have many wonderful questions already, and questions keep coming. Some of them are very Polish grounded, some of them are quite general. So I'll try to go back and forth between them. Here's a great one for those of us who spend more time in Poland, and I think this is a question I wish I had thought to ask. Who do you consider to be your mentor and why?
In what sense?
In what sense?
No, because, yeah. You cannot vote, yes? No, but but that's a good idea because I cannot run again and he cannot vote. So we have one task. It's necessary to change Polish constitution for him and for me. But no, that is different story. If you ask me about mentors, that is very, you know, first of all, I have to say that I have very good parents, so I'm from good family, that's first. So genetic was not bad. Second, I had good school. Third, I was in very interesting place in my university because it was Gdańsk. And Gdańsk in the 70s was very much open place for exchange of minds, much more as Warsaw, for example, because it was on the coast of Baltic Sea, much more open place. Then in the year 76, I decided as a very young man, 21, the witness of my trip is here, I decided to make such unbelievable trip to the United States. And the reason to visit United States was bicentennial, in fact. You know, that's a crazy reason, you know, to see some sail operation or sail exhibition in New York or something like that. It was a little bit crazy. But we decided to visit America, and I think this trip was very important for me because those times we understood what is a real difference between democratic states and states of freedom and such countries as Poland. Then, of course, I met very good professors. I met nice friends. So the list of mentors would be quite long, but I wasn't the man from one political school. So that is not so like President Chirac, who is a Gaullist, and his mentor was a long time General de Gaulle, and successors of General de Gaulle. No, I'm not so such oriented. With President Chirac, sometimes I have the impression that very long time he was sure that he's the best son of President de Gaulle. Last years he's sure that he's the father of de Gaulle, but that is a joke, of course. In my opinion, I had I met very interesting people in Poland and abroad, and I think my intellectual formation is connected with many people. I cannot name one who had such very special impact on my political thinking and political life.
Thank you. Here's a general question. Have you ever found situations where a compromise was not possible?
Unfortunately, yes. Unfortunately, yes, of course, and that is, of course, if you are a man of compromise, it's necessary, that is like the man in the medical doctor, it's necessary to use all methods to the end and take all efforts. But of course, sometimes the situation is so difficult, so complicated, opponents are so unable to make compromise that you have no chance. And then, of course, you have sometimes it's necessary to observe how many bad things will happen, and they happen. Sometimes the time, the factor of time, is very important. It's necessary to wait, but keep some contact. I'm very interested I'm so sorry that I changed, but this is additional remark to this question. I'm very interested how this report of Baker-Hamilton Commission will be published, because in my opinion, one of the main advice in this. I don't know nothing. I think it's so only. One of main advice in this report should be that it's necessary to start to have talks with Syrians, Iranians, not only through European Union or China or United Nations, but directly by some special envoys from American side with these countries. Because, yeah, no, that is not for applause. That's why is it important? Because if you cannot find the solution, if you cannot find a compromise, it's necessary to keep dialogue, to have a chance to continue, even this, if these talks are totally unsuccessful, if sometimes are boring, and sometimes are frustrating, it's necessary to keep this ties of dialogue. And it, in my opinion, America and last years, they made such mistake. Because this, to name this acts of...
Access of evil,
and etc., it means that we will not discuss with you. And that is that sounds good, because you are strong, you are tough, you know, you have own values, but practically that is very difficult to find compromise one day. Nobody knows when. But one day, if you need to have compromise, to reach compromise, it's necessary to keep this dialogue. I think in international politics, compromise is the best solution, what I said. Sometimes it's impossible to reach the compromise immediately. Sometimes it's necessary to be very patient and to wait. But it's necessary to keep this dialogue. And that is what I suggest to Americans very much. Because, you know, sometimes that's a difficult job, but sometimes at the end of the day you can reach good results. So, that is, you know, compromise, that is not a problem of politics. Compromise is a problem of life. And, you know, I said many times when I was accused that I'm a man of compromise and why I want to have compromise, I said, look, if in your private life you will not use the concept of compromise, if the people will not be able to find compromise, the civilization would exist, I don't know, 20 years, 30 years, not so many thousand years. And you, if you are with your wives, or the wives are your with husbands, and will not use the method of compromise, what means? No chances. Every day of our life is a compromise. Compromise, that's something very constructive. Sounds not good. Sounds like a weakness. No, that is a sign of very wise approach to everything. Even that you accept my long answers, that is a sign of your compromise.
Or our wisdom. Back to Poland. Do you envision for yourself a return to active politics in Poland? If so, might this involve an attempt to create an alliance of some sort between the left, SLD, SDPL, and the center, Platforma Obywatelska?
No, that's brief answer. So first, you know, for former president to find formal role in the politics, domestic politics, is very difficult. And still, I don't know, the situation is changing, but frankly speaking, today I cannot imagine such position for me in Polish politics. But I'm very much interested to support this new coalition, leftists from SLD, leftists from Social Democratic Party, and centrists from former Union of Freedom or Union of Democrats. I think this party is necessary for Polish democracy, will play important role as a kind of balance in this very shaking political scene. So that's, I will support them. I supported them. I participated in some meeting, and I'm very much interested to see that this party should be one of the three main important parties in Poland, with peace, parties of the Twins, and Platforma Obywatelska, Citizens Platform. So, but you know, what former president can do? To be minister, to be member of the parliament, to be prime minister. You know, in fact, you know, only one position in Poland is more important as Polish president. This is the chief of Polish Catholic Church. But that is not for me because it's necessary to divorce with my wife. And I love her. I love her. After 30 years, we are so close that, you know, no chance. Of course, it was a joke as well. So I speak to the journalists, you know, that underline that the last part of my answer was a joke.
I think we're getting it.
Yeah, I hope so. No, you too. You of course, but I speak about journalists.
Well, given that your visit is supported in part by the European Commission, I'm glad to see there's a question about the European Union as well, and not just about America and Poland. Here, the person asks, part of Poland's success as global citizens involved their membership in NATO and the European Union. What do you see as Poland's next role in the international community? And may I add to this question, what do you see as the principal, you know, maybe even foreign policy challenges for the European Union itself, and what role might Poland or Polish leaders themselves play in identifying those and helping to resolve them?
Thanks very much for this question. I prepared my part of my lecture was about European Union, but it was too long. And the first of all, it's necessary to say European Union is a very successful project. It's one, in my opinion, in the history of the civilization, and especially the last centuries of the civilization, the projects of European integration is the second so successful and so clever after United States. Because to organize European integration, it was not the common will of everybody. It was not common will of nations in Europe. It was prepared idea of very clever fathers of European integration, like fathers of United States more as 200 years ago, to organize some structure which will be useful to protect democracy, good values, good economy, good governance, etc., human rights. And this idea of EU is really very successful. This idea guaranteed 50 years of peace and security for Western Europe after Second World War. And please remember that the concept of European Union was born among the countries which were in the war against each other during Second World War. Because the concept was organized by Germans, France, Italy, Belgium, Holland, and Luxembourg. So that all these countries were in different places of the war. And to understand that, to overcome the war, and to overcome this bad memory of the war, and to overcome this very painful years and the huge number of victims, is necessary to integrate Europe on the base of same democratic values, on the base of the protection of human rights, on the base of free market economy, on the base of very close cooperation with the United States, which is necessary to understand. And the beginning of European Union still is a very close concept, very close cooperation with the United States. European Union was not built against United States. It was not, at the beginning and even now, it's not a concept how to compete with United States. Of course, this competition in the economy is quite obvious. When we produce cars, so we start to compete with America. What to do that Europe produce better cars? What we can do, you know? It was a joke. But such, you know, a joke with some real argument. Okay.
It's a sensitive issue in Michigan.
Yeah, especially here, of course. Yeah. No, it was a joke, okay. In Detroit, with General Motors and Ford, that's absolutely a joke. No, dear friends, so European Union was very successful project. Then European Union had really success with enlargement. I know that even in Europe, we have a lot of opponents of this last enlargement by 10 countries. But in my opinion, that is the next argument in favor of European Union. Because today, and especially beginning of next year with Romania and Bulgaria, Europe will have almost 500 million people. I would like to congratulate America that you have 300 million people here. I would like to convey my best congratulations for all of you who contributed in this huge job. Bravo, good. 300 million, that's very, very impressive. But Europe, European Union integrated EU has almost 500. That's a huge potential, that's a huge labor market. That's a huge market for everything. And that is positive. What is the problem of European Union? We have strong problems. The first, Europe never be something like United States. Sometimes European Union was named, that is a new concept of United States of Europe. No chances. No chances, because the fundamental element and pillar of European Union is diversity. We will speak different languages. We will have different cultures. We will have different churches, religions, etc. And this diversity is not a problem, in fact. This diversity is the richness of Europe. Europe is interesting because it's so different. I remember my meeting some years ago with Newt Gingrich when Baltic states started to access NATO. And I was very much engaged, and I started to explain why these three countries should be in NATO. And I see that Newt Gingrich is more and more surprised. Why? Because I explained to him that these three small countries, Estonia has 2 million people, Latvia 2 million, Lithuania 4 million. In these three countries, they speak totally different languages. They cannot communicate each other because the languages are from different group of languages. They have three different religions, Lithuania Catholics, Latvia Protestants, Estonia Finnish Protestants, Finnish Evangelics or something. And you know, I see that after our discussion that Newt Gingrich is surprised because he was sure that if in Europe we have three small states on the coast of Baltic Sea, that is something like Massachusetts, Maine, and Delaware. You know, same language, same tradition, same culture, same rules of the market, everything same. No, Europe is so diverse that even in such small piece on the coast of Baltic Sea, you have three totally different countries. And such countries we have a lot. So diversity is one of the fundamentals of European integrity. And in this, and that is why Europe will not be in the future United States of Europe. But European integrated continent could be and should be. So it's necessary to understand this situation. Second, I think the problem of European Union today is a lack of some common policies, and especially common foreign policy and common security policy. And that is really the problem, and I used this common European policy when I was in Ukraine in this end of 2004, but I'm very much disappointed that Europe is not able to solve such very European problems like Belarus, lack of democracy in Belarus, like split of Moldova, like conflict in like the future of Kosovo, like conflict between Slovenia and Croatia, like tensions in Balkans. I cannot understand why Europe is not so active and why we don't have common policy vis-a-vis these places. Why we? And then we are very much surprised or even frustrated that America started to solve these problems. In fact, without United States, it could be impossible to solve the problems of Balkans. So this common policy of Europe is needed. We need this policy very, very soon, and that is necessary. Same in security. Still, Europe has not the forces of rapid reaction, and some units which are ready to go to some difficult places to manage the situation. So that is a lack of European policy, and the next lack of European situation is Europe is unfortunately is a place of a lot of national egoisms. Egoism. So we have a lot of political parties and political leaders very selfish. We have, and still is necessary to explain to European public opinion and especially European politicians that more integrated Europe is better for all of us in Europe. To keep this very national approach to many problems is a weakness of European integration. Don't worry about own culture, about own tradition, about own cuisine, about everything, you know. You know, Europe will be interesting for us Europeans, not only for Americans, if in France you will have French cuisine, and in Poland Polish cuisine, and Germany good beer, and in Russia good something, yeah. That is something what is interesting for all of us. But the problem is that sometimes, I remember this last point, so I promised you that will be a brief answer, yeah. When Poland discussed association treaty with European Union, it was the year 92-93, I remember such debate in Polish parliament, I was member of the parliament, and very such right-oriented group of Polish traditionalists, conservative Catholics, so-called Zjednoczenie Chrześcijańsko Narodowe, the unity of national Christians, something like that, they were very much against. And the main argument of this group was, we have to fight for our heritage, for our tradition, for our values, for our culture, for our religion, for everything. Yeah. And then I had speech, it was long discussion in the night, I said, look, if you want to fight for your heritage, tradition, culture, values, etc., you can't win this fight only in the competition. Only if you are confronted with the different values, different tradition, different cultures, and different languages. And if you will win, it means that you are strong, you are good, and you will fight. And what is your proposal? Not to go to European Union, and what? To keep all this heritage, tradition, culture, language in the museum? And to show for the tourists how nice tradition, language, culture we have? That's everything that is life, that is what we have to offer as our contribution to our common world, to our common Europe. And not to keep it and then look, you know, that is, you know, we have such nations and we have such places that we can observe how nice heritage was in some tribes in 12th or 13th century. But in 15th it finished. So in 15th century was finished this history of this tribe because it was without this competition, without the contacts with the world. So, European Union has chances, big chances. I'm optimistic. I think because of European Union, Europe has a chance to be one of the main global centers in the 21st and next century, with United States, North America, United States, Canada, with China, with Japan, Asia, which maybe South America, because separately, even the strongest European countries like Germany, France, or United Kingdom, they have not such chances. They are too small, and they have aging societies, and they have no chances to participate in global competition and global challenges of the 21st century. Yes, you have. I have time, so that's, you know, I'm former president. I have time now. Please.
So here's a question that actually follows on the last one, and I think many people are interested in this answer. Are you worried about the political direction in which Russia seems to be going?
How to say? The first today I see it in. Information that President Putin said that he will not run for third term. And I think that's, I would like to say that I have respect to this decision. Because he's very popular. He would win the election without problems. And if he decided to finish according to the Constitution, two terms and not to run again, it means something positive and promising. that democratic procedures, democratic rules will be respected in Russia. That is what I would like to say on the, as a beginning of my answer. Second, I think the main problem of Russia is that still Russia, after everything what happened in last 17 years, is not able to define own position and own role in the world. Because Russia lost a lot. It's necessary to understand that Russia lost, I don't know how many percent of territory, I don't know how many, no, almost 50%, even more, of population. That today, out of Russia are such places which were part of Soviet Union, like going from Asia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, Azerbaijan, Armenia, Georgia, Belarus, Moldova, Ukraine, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia. So they lost in very short period, in some years, they lost so much territory, they lost a lot of population, and I think they lost some concept, what is Russia today, and what should be Russia now. And I think that is one of the main problems for political leaders, for intellectuals, for academics, and for the people. Because I spoke about it with Professor Kennedy yesterday. I remember, and during Orange Revolution, I had an interview with very famous journalist from Russia, Anatoly Kisilov. He worked in Khodorkovsky's TV, and this TV is closed now, but very clever guy. And we discussed about reaction of Russians of everything what is happening in Ukraine. And of course, this journalist is very pro-democratic oriented guy. And he told me one thing which I will remember whole life, you know. He said, Mr. President, you should understand one thing. For normal Russians, I don't speak about leaders, I don't speak about some politicians, I speak about normal people in Moscow or somewhere in Russia. They never accept that Ukraine is some different place. And it's not a part of Russian state or empire, name how you want. Because two things for these people are crucial. The first, how to accept that Crimea, this nice peninsula on the Black Sea, is not Russia. They spent in this place childhood, students' time. They were there with young wives, then a little bit older wives, with kids and then grandchildren. And it was a part of Soviet Union. And Crimea is part of their life. They were every summer in Crimea, first. And second, how to explain to the fan of soccer in Moscow that the champion of Soviet Union 23 times, Dynamo Kiev, is not a Russian club? And this Ukrainian club. How to explain? That is, you know, it's impossible. So I think psychologically I can understand a lot, and I understand that politically Russia has a problem with own definition, and I think it will take a lot of time. What is concerning politics of Mr. Putin, I understand that he had some difficult task to integrate the power in this country, after a lot of difficult events which happened before. He has a lot of luck, because during his presidency the prices of gas and oil increased twice or three times, what is for each president in the world the best information. Of course, after September 11th, he started to be a very important player in the international politics again, because it's difficult to imagine a successful and efficient anti-terrorist coalition without Russia. And if I have something what is a serious problem, and in my opinion is a mistake of Mr. Putin, I don't speak about Polish-Russian relation, because that is too complicated, and that is for next lecture, not for tonight. And I would like, you want to sleep well, me too, so that is better not to think about such difficult issues. But what is the real weakness of Putin's politics? In my opinion, Russians, of course, historically, they are not prepared to have civil society. But in my opinion, this government, this president, he didn't do nothing to have such civil society. And in my opinion, civil society is, in fact, precondition of good state, of democracy, and of good position in the world. I cannot see in longer term, in short term, this is quite possible, but in longer term, I'm absolutely not believe in the concept of centralized state with lack of civil society, which can be active and efficient domestically and internationally. So I don't believe in good future of China. I don't believe in good future of Russia without civil society. Of course, to compare civil society in China and to compare civil society in Russia, this picture looks much better for Russia, of course. You know. But still, that is not civil society. And I think this, the precondition of positive processes in all countries in this our sphere and in our tradition, our culture, and especially Russia, because Russia is connected with European culture, with European tradition, with Christian tradition as well. I think that is civil society. And now I will be a little bit prophet, but in my opinion, this situation will change. It will start change with next president, but even I connect the situation not so much with politicians. I'm sure that the main change and the real push and such explosion of civil society will start with new Russian generation. Studying today in good Russian universities abroad, in Europe, in United States, with new heroes of this generation, good businessmen, athletes, intellectuals, it will start. The question is next 10 years, next 15 years, but the process is complicated and not easy. But that is something what, in my opinion, is a main weakness of Russia today and the chance for Russia, because I spoke with Putin many times. He said, well, we have no democratic traditions. What is true? What is true? But I said, and what? So what? You will wait? Or so that you will have this democratic tradition like a souvenir from somewhere? It's necessary to create such approach, to create such people, to educate such people, to create such procedures. That is a very difficult process, but it's possible. It's possible. I can tell you about many countries in the world with lack of democratic traditions, and after quite short time they started to be very democratic. Look Japan, look Germany after the war, look Poland. So that is difficult, but possible.
I know that we're moving toward the conclusion of our evening, but I know there are a lot of people here who would be interested in your comments on the present political scene in Poland. And I know you're, as a former president, it's difficult for you to comment on these things. But here's one question that sounds like a political scientist asked it. And you might answer it as a political scientist or as a former president. How long, in your opinion, will the present coalition survive?
I hope not too long. But I hope so. But it's impossible. Not too long. Of course, this year for sure we have 2 months. And next year, seriously speaking, what is decisive question? Result of local election. Local elections are coming 12th of November, very soon. And if in this election, and I think in this election, why I don't think that the parliamentary election will come very soon, because in my opinion, The result of local election will be not very sensational. It, of course, it will be success of Platforma Obywatelska, some weaker position of PiS, the party of Kaczyński's brother, but this is not dramatic change, because in big cities, negative opinion about PiS are very strong, but in the province, not so much. That is still, the process is more complicated. But even if the result will be not good for coalition, that is such atmosphere that, well, this result was not good, but now we will work very good, very positive, and then we are not interested to organize election very soon, because every month will give us more chances. What is, of course, a wrong approach, and it was one of the sources of defeat, very dramatic defeat, of Social Democrats, of Left Alliance. Because Left Alliance, if would organize election 1 year earlier, would have much better result. Of course, not winning result, but better result. So we'll see. That's you know, is, I don't know how to translate to English, but nobody is prophet in own country, so I'm not a prophet in my country. So that's, be careful with my opinions about all the things. I'm better prophet for Ukraine, for Russia, even for the United States, but for Poland, it's sometimes. Is such sentence in English? In
an expression? I don't know.
No, it's nobody is a prophet in own country.
We think we can do everything here.
Yeah.
I know this question will go right to your heart. Maybe it's a good way to conclude. You ready?
Yeah. I'm afraid, I'm not totally ready.
Will Poland qualify for the European Football Championships? Will Ben Hacken, be given enough time to change the mentality of Polish players? I know you don't want to comment
The first, I hope yes. And I have some evidence to say yes, because first time after very, very long time, Poland won in the match against very strong team, Portugal. You know, during last World Championship, Portugal was in the semi-final. They were on the fourth position, and we won this match, and I didn't see the match because I was here, but I was informed by my friends, by phone, about everything what is going on the pitch. And really, it was sensational. In 18 minutes, the result was 2-0 for Poland. So that's the fans in the stadium, they were sure that they are dreaming or something like that. First time in the history of Polish national team, we have foreign coach. And in my opinion, that is good decision. Because this man is a very famous Dutch coach, Leo Benhakker, and he has such new approach, fresh approach to everything. I remember that the team from Warsaw, Legia Warszawa, had the problems for a very long time to be number one in Poland, having all everything, money, players, etc. And they decided to engage very unknown Serb coach, Okuka, from Serbia, and they won twice Polish championship. And what was the change? Because to change mentality is extremely difficult. And I think no one coach is able to change mentality of the nation, you know. Even presidents are not able to change the mentality, you know. Even Polish Pope, during very long time of his papacy, was not able to change the mentality. It's something much more complicated. But what can do good coach? Because he's new man, absolutely with fresh look, he's going to the stadium and during exercises, during training, he looks and the final decision of the coach is end. Next match, we'll play. Number 3, 4, 7, 11, 15, 22, 25, only numbers. And some who, and Janek will not play, and Franek will not play, and Juzek will not play. And what is Juzek? Who is Franek? Who is Janek? I said who will play. He's not connected with everything what is in the team, in this group, who is friend of the chairman of the club, who is better guy, who proposed some drinks after the match, who is who, etc. That is something what can survive our national team. The man who is totally fresh and who is looking for skills of these guys and not for all these, you know, situations and contacts and links, etc. We'll see. It looks better as we expected before. And of course, please be careful with this explanation, because even if we have one Dutchman as a coach of Polish national team in soccer, that is necessary to have Polish president as a president of Poland, and we have survived with Polish presidents, not Dutch presidents or Americans. And I think that's an interesting experience. And finally, it was such a little bit funny conclusion for this meeting, and I repeat that I'm very moved that I can be here in Ann Arbor, in Michigan University, to meet you. I hope that it's not our last meeting we discussed today, that maybe we'll continue our cooperation. And I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your interest about Poland and everything what is going in our region, in Central and Eastern Europe. And I wish you all the best. I wish you good election, 7th November in the United States. What is important for you and for all of us, because I think if we want to see future of the world in good colors with some positive elements, America is playing absolutely crucial role, and your decision 7th November are more important as you think about it sometimes. So thank you very much for your attention, thank you very much for your friendship, for your hospitality, and to the next time. Dziękuję bardzo, dobranoc.